I'd never heard anything like it.
So much more than music.
It is no mystery at all to me that the man has become the biggest thing in the history of entertainment.
It was the summer of 1953 when Elvis Presley first set foot in Sun Records. To Sun staff, he was just like any other teenager there to record a double-sided record for $3.98. Little did they know, Elvis would become one of the most influential people in the history of music. He recorded My Happiness and That's When Your Heartache Begins, both of which survived and are still enjoyed today. Elvis would return to Sun in January of 1954. At this visit, the owner of Sun Records, Sam Phillips, is present and is fascinated by Elvis for his new personality, style, and sound. He describes Elvis as a white man with a Negro sound and the Negro feel. The public was starting to recognize Elvis, and they couldn't get enough of him. On October 16, 1954, Elvis made his first appearance on the Louisiana Hayride, a popular Saturday night radio show.
He's only 19 years old. He has a new, distinctive style. Elvis Presley. Let's give him a nice hand. We've been singing his songs around here for weeks and weeks and weeks. Elvis, how are you this evening?
It's fine. How are you, sir?
Are you all geared up with your band there?
Geared up.
So let us hear your songs.
Well, I'd like to say how happy we are to be down here. It's a real honor for us to be... get a chance to appear on the Louisiana Hayride. We're going to do a song for you. You got anything else to say, sir?
No, I'm ready.
We're going to do a song for you. We've got on Sun Record. It goes something like this.
That's all right, Mama. That's all right with you.
He received raving reviews from the people that would intently watch as Elvis rose to fame. By 1955, Elvis was making regular appearances on the Louisiana Hayride and was touring constantly. 1956 brought big things for Elvis. On January 27, his first number one hit, Heartbreak Hotel, was released. Today it remains almost as popular as it was at its release. Later that year, Presley's self-titled debut album was released, becoming the first rock and roll album to top the Billboard charts. Elvis's sound was a breath of fresh air for the people of the 1950s. He invented his own rockabilly style that featured booming instrumentation and fast, catchy rhythms much different from that of the crooners of the 1940s and early 50s. He wasn't afraid to break the racial barrier and sing pieces originally recorded by African-American artists, and he introduced music that was heavily influenced by the African-American styles of Memphis's Beale Street. Elvis had become the next big thing. The teenage girls flocked to him for his charm and good looks like they never had done before, and others were simply mesmerized by Presley for his ability to reinvent the entire music scene. Thanks to Elvis, rock and roll was sweeping the nation as he made appearances on television shows such as The Ed Sullivan Show and The Milton Berle Show.
Well, baby, if I made you mad, something I might have said.
It's one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready. Now go, cat, go, but don't you step on my blue face.
Watched as Elvis swung his hips in a manner that was declared unfit for family viewing by Ed Sullivan. The dancing drove the girls crazy and earned him the nickname Elvis the Pelvis. According to Presley, this was one of the most childish expressions I ever heard coming from an adult. Elvis's dancing wasn't the only thing that caught the people's attention. His style was unlike anything the people had ever seen before. He started some of the most iconic fashion trends of the 1950s. Teenagers adopted a new style, known today as rockabilly, after the style of music that influenced it. Boys grew out and styled their hair like Elvis, and girls and boys alike began to wear things that their elders considered edgy. To the teenagers of the 1950s, Elvis was an inspiration, a rebel. To adults, he was obnoxious. Parents were outraged as their children fell in love with Elvis and his hip swaying antics. Some parents were especially horrified by the effect Elvis had on their children. They despised him and believed that they needed to stop Elvis for the good of their children. A Los Angeles writer wrote, "Let me admit at the outset that I don't like Elvis Presley. He's the kind of a child that other children are traditionally not allowed to play with. He's a sullen, ill-kempt-looking youth. If he was my kid, I'd smack that sneer off his face and send him out for a haircut." March 24th, 1958, was a day that sent Elvis fans into a state of panic. It was then that he entered the United States Army.
Elvis Presley no longer has that rock and roll beat. The tempo is hop, two, three, four, four, five.
Protests emerged in Washington, and fans personally sent messages to the White House. One fan wrote to First Lady Mamie Eisenhower, "Dear Mamie, will you please be so sweet and kind as to tell Ike to please bring Elvis Presley back to us from the Army? We need him in our entertainment world to make us all laugh." Although this military career was short, it was enough to impact American culture. The classic, Tony Award-winning musical, Bye Bye Birdie, was inspired by Elvis' draft notice into the Army and the fan hysteria surrounding it. Not surprisingly, Bye Bye Birdie remains a popular choice for high school and college productions. After 2 years in military service, Elvis Presley returned to Memphis. It wasn't long until he was back in the studio recording some of his best love hits, It's Now or Never and Are You Lonesome Tonight. As the 1960s rolled in, Elvis remained popular and maintained international fame. Around this time, he would enter the world of Hollywood movies.
Vince Everett, dynamically portrayed by Elvis Presley, was a tough blackboard jungle kid.
And you were heaven to me, Hawaiian sunset.
These films were all very profitable, and some, such as Jailhouse Rock and Blue Hawaii, remain classics to this day. Starting in 1973, with his divorce from his wife Priscilla, Elvis's health was beginning to deteriorate. He began to lose interest in visiting the recording studio, and recording in general, even from his own home, was now difficult for him. He battled with his health issues for years as he tried to continue his musical career until August 16, 1977. At age 42, Elvis Presley died in his Tennessee home, Graceland, of cardiac arrhythmia. His death rocked the nation. Radio stations organized tributes to Elvis as fans listened devastated and shocked. He had lived an extraordinary life that would not end after his death. Elvis lives on in his movies and music, which are still widely popular, and through the influence he had on fans throughout the world and on other musical artists. The Beatles and Led Zeppelin are only two of the other legendary artists inspired by Elvis. John Lennon himself openly admitted, "If there hadn't have been Elvis, there wouldn't have been the Beatles." And he was right. Without Elvis, we wouldn't have the rock and roll music that had become a symbol of American culture and that was loved by people throughout the world. Even today, thousands of people relive the life of Elvis at Graceland, his home purchased in 1957, that is open to the public for tours. Each year, Graceland receives over 700,000 visits from Elvis fans or people who simply want to experience a piece of rock and roll history. You don't have to be an Elvis fan to recognize the true impact Elvis had on the world. Even the fact that Elvis is known all over the world just by his first name shows us that Elvis truly is the one and only king of rock and roll.
You know, someone said the world's a stage.